This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book The Trained Memory by Warren Hilton. Chapter 1, The Elements of Memory. You have learned of the sense perceptive and judicial processes by which your mind acquires its knowledge of the outside world. You come now to a study of the phenomenon of memory, the instrument by which your mind retains and makes use of its knowledge, the agency that has power to resurrect the buried past, or power to enfold us in a paradise of dreams more perfect than reality. In the broadest sense, memory is the faculty of the mind by which we 1. Retain, 2. Recall, 3. Picture to the mind's eye, and 4. Recognize past experiences. Memory involves, therefore, 4 elements: retention, recall, imagination, and recognition. End of the chapter. Chapter 2, The Mental Treasure Vault and Its Lost Combination. Almost everyone seems to think that we retain in the mind only those things that we can voluntarily recall. That memory, in other words, is limited to the power of voluntary reproduction. This is a profound error. It is an inexcusable error. The daily papers are constantly reporting cases of the lapse and restoration of memory that contain all the elements of underlying truth on this subject. It is plain enough that the memory seems decidedly limited in its scope. This is because our power of voluntary recall is decidedly limited. But it does not follow simply because we are without the power to deliberately recall certain experiences that all mental trace of those experiences is lost to us. Those experiences that we are unable to recall are those that we disregarded when they occurred because they possessed no special interest for us. They are there, but no mental associations or connections with power to awaken them have arisen in consciousness. Things are continually happening all around us that we see with but half an eye. They are in the fringe of consciousness, and we deliberately ignore them. Many more things come to us in the form of sense impressions that clamorously assail our sense organs, but no effort of the will is needed to ignore them. We are absolutely impervious to them, and unconscious of them, because by the selection of our life interests we have closed the doors against them. In either case, whether in the fringe of consciousness or entirely outside of consciousness, these unperceived sensations will be found to be sensory images that have no connection with the present subject of thought. They therefore attract, and we spare them, no part of our attention. Just as each of our individual sense organs selects from the multitude of ether vibrations constantly beating upon the surface of the body only those waves to the velocity of which it is attuned, so each one of us as an integral personality selects from the stream of sensory experiences only those particular objects of attention that are in some way related to the present or habitual trend of thought. Just consider for a moment the countless number and variety of impressions that assail the eye and ear of the New Yorker who walks down Broadway in a busy hour of the day. Yet to how few of these does he pay the slightest attention? He is in the midst of a cataclysm of sound almost equal to the roar of Niagara, and he does not know it. Observe how many objects are right now in the corner of your mind's eye as being within the scope of your vision, while your entire attention is apparently absorbed in these lines. You see these other things, and you can look back and realize that you have seen them, but you were not aware of them at the time. Let two individuals of contrary tastes take a day's outing together. Both may have during the day practically identical sensory images, but each one will come back with an entirely different tale to tell of the day's adventures. All sensory impressions, somehow or other, leave their faint impress on the waxen tablets of the mind. Few are or can be voluntarily recalled. Just where and how memories are retained is a mystery. There are theories that represent sensory experiences as actual physiological impressions on the cells of the brain. They are, however, nothing but theories, and the manner in which the brain, as the organ of the mind, keeps its record of sensory experiences has never been discovered. Microscopic anatomy has never reached the point where it could identify a particular idea with any one cell or other part of the brain. For us, the important question is not how, but how much, not the manner in which, but the extent to which sensory impressions are preserved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.